Everybody starts from somewhere. I went to Ohio State University because my parents decided I couldn't stay home. And I'm like, I don't want to leave. Every institution around D.C. I applied to accepted me. So I ended up at Ohio State working for a black newspaper called Artichoke Times. Now mind you, I'm a bassoon major, minoring in piano and clarinet, but I got struck by the bug of what photography could do. To go from that to him, believe I thought I'd die to him. He was like, really? And you couldn't find our office without that little sign on it. We were in a corner of a gymnasium called Pomeroy Hall. You had to find that sign. We brought Angela Davis to campus when she got out of jail. You know, we got to be markers. And we had fun putting the paper out. That's me on the far right-hand side there. Yeah. And I'm about 40 pounds lighter than, you know, students don't know how to eat. I like hot dogs and Spam just fine. But I learned how to appreciate people who didn't like things and make demonstrations. And I started shooting that stuff. I was taking photography part-time and doing music full-time. This guy right here is a brave man. He was the assistant dean of students at school. And a lot of people wouldn't take the time to be a sponsor with you. But he did. He ended up sponsoring 15 groups so we could function on campus. We go on to do things, and Michael White becomes the first black president of the undergraduate student body, and Matt becomes the vice president. They want the coalition between black and white folk on campus to continue, because Michael's about to graduate, and me too. Things got better when we all started to talk to each other. So they talked me into running for vice president, and Dennis Sargent, who was a real farmer, became the president. It was fun years later to go back to Cleveland, Ohio, where now Michael is the mayor of Cleveland. And a new stadium was opened up for the Cleveland Indians. And he's glad to be there. Me too, because I love baseball. We worked really hard together. And I also was the person that had to sign the check. So me and the rest of the USG Council weren't getting along. You want to pay Elvis Presley $20,000? And I'm asking for $10,000 for Black History Month, there's a problem. I wouldn't sign the check, so they gave me my check. So when I got back to DC after being an intern at Associated Press, I started working stuff around town. And I'm also in a camera store. And somebody said, $300 looking for somebody to do their next album cover. And when I show my portfolio to them, Bernice Johnson Reagan in the middle, who's also in Danny Lyon's exhibit as a civil rights singer, she was bad. She still is bad. She's still alive. And I did real good with them. And things go on, and Bernice grows, I grow. She says, why aren't you working for yourself? Light bulb goes off. I don't even tell my dear parents that I quit my job. Only person I told was my grandmother, who kept my secret for about 6 months. So I go home to have dinner with my parents one day, and my father says, so, how long have you been gone? Uh-oh, husband. And my mother says, I called the store yesterday. They said, you've been gone. I say, uh-oh. And then my parents say, look at here. We're going to help support you. We're going to pay your car insurance. We're going to pay your health insurance. But see how it goes. You might have a career after all. So I started working for everybody. This is a Morgan State University. This girl's singing so hard and so fierce. I'm digging the reaction. That's not her, but her mates around her going, oh, she stepped into another dimension. I started working for other artists who wanted to put their stuff out. Because by doing stuff and getting photo credit, you knew that you could do a difference. We did a project called Songs of My People, and everything I shot in San Francisco and Oakland didn't make the cut. But I come back to D.C., the project is still open, and they tell me about this little old lady, 89 years old, who hula hoops and rides a bicycle. So I went out to her house in Brentwood, Maryland, and lo and behold, I had the best time with an 89-year-old. There's always good things going on. Civil activists who want stuff done. Some people are so serious about what they do, don't have a hearse bring me to the church. Y'all won't take me to the church. So through the streets of D.C. for more than 10 blocks, these folk went up 14th Street and turned down Newton Street to get to St. Stephen's Church. This is a gray panther, a fierce gray panther. She and the people from the Senate who were old enough to know what needed to happen, they made happen. Ah, my man. Sometime between things, he's waiting. Things are getting set up. I saw that shot, and I just got it. I'm like, aha! The other fun stuff is you always want to catch the airplanes when they go off at Annapolis or Air Force Base. Because if he catches that shot, he's not bad at getting to be a good photographer. He did the troops. This just blows me away. This is the daughter of James Byrd, who was dragged through Texas and decapitated, mutilated, gunned him. And George Bush and this great Texas legislature would not talk to her about hate crimes. So when Clinton came, he just hugged her, and she just cried. This is in India. We have gone to Mother Teresa's funeral, and Mrs. Clinton represented us.
I thought I'd die and go to heaven. My dad in Kente Cloth, yes. And his wife in Kente Cloth, yes.
They all had their own interpreters. The lady met with the lady, the man met with the man. And I just see all this stuff going, oh, we can take this picture of her. She was also a good flower designer. So she decided what colors need to be, and they talked about what to do for the state dinner that was coming. These guys are getting ready to go into the Oval and explain to the president what's coming up. The one on the other side, that was Elena Kagan, who's now Supreme Court Justice. So good government jobs, take your places. This is all of us talking. I hear everything. Got top secret clearance. We're on our way to the birthday celebration. And no matter what they did, no matter where they walked, I just turn around and I catch a great shot. This is Albert Eisenstock, the famous light photographer. And we're in Martha's Vineyard, and he knows Chelsea likes the ballet stuff. So he presented a picture of the ballet to Chelsea and the Clintons. Ah, Teddy Kennedy, the Democrat for real. He's a bad boy, he's missed, because what we got in there now is a little bit cowardly. This is the Delaney sisters. They're both over 100 here. And we're in Mount Vernon, New York. And they're explaining how they do their thing, how they stretch, how they do garlic. They do yoga every day. The jar of garlic was that big, full of cloves. It popped like it was mint. We go down to Texas, Atlanta, Georgia, Zell Miller's territory. And this is probably one of the last lunches President Clinton had like this. This is at the UN, and we're walking through the hallways, and the guy that comes is passing, the guy who's getting ready to go to office is in the middle. On the far left-hand side is the president, premier of Pakistan. This is Boyd Air Force One. I call it a big flat office building. And sometimes the days were long. When we got off the planes, I always had to be downstairs first, go out the back of the door, and then be waiting as President Clinton came down the steps, that every hand that's in the line, he would shake. And I take everybody's pictures so they can get their photos. And at the end of the day, I got gear around me. I ain't need to go to the gym. I'm strong because I got to carry this stuff and walk all the time. This is like a going away picture for the National Security Council. So as we began to get out of office, we started to bring all the teams together. I got good at large crowds, larger crowds, large crowds. This is the farewell picture for the cabinet. And the last cabinet pictures had always been done in the cabinet room. I'm thinking outside the box. Let's go out to the front lawn. I had to get the Secret Service, the military, the usher's office, the guys who manage the building. I had to get all this cooperation. And on every roof within a mile, there were snipers up there. If anything went wrong, there's going to be some trouble. I started doing boxing. I started working for MGM Grand when they made it a money hole ground in D.C. It's a casino. They call it entertainment, but I call it, that's a lot of money. I learned that I like Sports Illustrated shooting because when I was growing up, my father got Sports Illustrated every week. And as soon as he got his hands finished with it, I was in it. So I knew I liked to shoot sports. And I did a good job, so now I had some more boxing gigs. And that's my art. It just can't quite see who's getting knocked out and punched in, but I thought that was art. And sometimes you just lose them. These things happen in boxing. I love basketball. This is the University of Maryland. We don't get enough basketball with the Washington Mystics in D.C., with the WNBA, so we start going to University of Maryland games and discover the girls were just bang. Can't block her. The one that's got her face covered, she's in the WNBA killing people. Yes, that was in the NBA killing people too. Delta Sigma Theta is my sorority. Wonderful Daisy Bates, who's a member of your tribe here in Little Rock. We celebrate her big time. She's a former national president. In 2013, we did the reenactment of our suffragette march. The Deltas had broken away from the AKAs because they wanted to do serious social things, and the AKAs wasn't having it. So they broke away, made Delta Sigma Theta, went to see the suffragettes, who put them at the rear of the line. So we are retracing the steps of our ancestors. I do bands. I love music. I have a studio. If you got a studio, you can get anybody in there and get some great work. Plus, you make the lights be what you want them to be. You do tests. You sit there yourself and go, how I look? Is that a good picture? Change the lights some more. Ah, this is Esther Williams and Danny Yarborough. I got to be really great friends with them, loving their jazz music. Davey's the head jazz instructor at Duke Ellington School for the Arts. And Esther just blows people away. She can sing. And I'm so proud of it, my friends. I go to all kinds of things because you don't know what you're going to see. And the more things you go to, the more things you see, you're like, golly, great. The more white people up there than black people come up here. Yes! You're getting somewhere. I love it when older people say, no, you're not going to ruin the environment. I know what's up. Women do all kinds of tasks now. This is at MGM Grand when I started Buddy Holding Ground. And I'm watching, it's like a document for me to do. And I was told to do artsy stuff too. I could tell, I was already doing artsy stuff. Mm-hmm. So when I pulled out the stuff I had and showed them, they're like, where this been? Y'all told me documentary. And I just did the best I could. This is my neighborhood. Block party, block party. Four block party kids in charge. I'm gonna draw chops around you. you strong, let's see you lift that. Roll it down the street. Wore him out. Censorship in our lives can affect what we see. It happens to us, and if we're lonely, and we're not having a good time, we gotta go to church, figure out what's happening. And after we go to church, if you die a noble death, you don't want to be forgotten. After all, you sacrificed. You were working so hard for the people, somebody took you out. The cowards took you out, shot you in the back. So, we have gentrification going on in D.C. It's not our first wave of gentrification. This is probably our third or fourth wave of gentrification. But his church kept getting moved because they declared the property to be theirs. If you don't run with one person, you gotta hang out with the crowd and enjoy stuff. Because when you enjoy stuff, you can listen to things. This is boombox. Go-go beat is coming off. The kids are recording the Junkyard Band in Anacostia Park. And that picture is also in the new museum up at NDC at the new National Museum of African American History and Culture. If you're going to take care of business, if people in wheelchairs come march, I don't want to hear excuses about people with too good legs. Because we want one America, we really do. That's what President Clinton and Ms. Clinton was about. Can we all not unite? Around the White House, we stop and high five, go five. I'm talking some new moves about the book. You got to do that. Keep everybody happy. Because we want to stand for something besides the usual crazy stuff. And if you help out a kid, it might turn you to be a good photographer. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. That was wonderful.
Anybody sleep on it?
So I want to thank UA Pulaski Tech again for having us here tonight. And this happens to be the second time I've been here in the last month.
Fist bump. You got to bite that.
So I'm very excited to be here with Sharon. We used to call Sharon at the White House the busiest person in the White House because she never had time to stop and like chat. She was running all the time behind President Clinton, and now we know that all paid off. So it is a wonderful, wonderful joy to be here with you. Since we've known each other more than 25 years, which is hard for me to remember, I'm still learning so much about you, and I'm hoping that the next 25 years I'll learn even more. I have a question for you. I want to start off by sharing with some of the audience that what part of your visit here is based on the exhibit that's outside, the Danny Lyon Memories of the Southern Civil Rights Movement. And I wanted to ask you this, what parallels are there between Danny Lyon's work for the civil rights effort and for your work that began during the civil rights era? What parallels would you say are between the two?
Passion, passion for people. I care about folks not being able to eat or get a good education, that the system doesn't work for everybody, but for a few. If you work hard, yes, you can overcome. But then there are people who do quite well, and they seem to be obstacles to the rest of us having success. Some learn how to skip around the obstacles, look on the bright side of things, and if you didn't speak to me, I'm gonna speak to you.
And I'm gonna look you in the eye.
Did you hear what I said? I said hello. I said good morning. Oh yeah. But if you don't call people on stuff, next time they see you, they're jumping and say, good morning, Sharon. So I know I've reached success.
Great.
And the other thing about Danny Lyons was that he was totally into shooting people getting mistreated by these so-called authorities. And at Ohio State, I felt like that because things weren't fair on campus. If you were a black student trying to get between classes, they would ask you for your student ID. If you were any white person hopping on a jitney anywhere, they ask you for nothing. So at some point, you get a little frustrated because you know by the time you pull out your so-called pass, you're watching three people walk past you who don't have a pass, don't gotta show nothing. That's a little irritating, to say the least. And that just galvanized me and some others even more to stop that jitney bus one day. You ain't rolling. So you treat everybody the same. Mm-hmm.
My next question, and I'm sure you've been asked this before, you were the first African-American and the first woman to head up the photography division in the White House.
Yes, but there was another photographer that came before me named Ricardo Thomas, who worked under the President Ford's administration. He started out as Rockefeller's photographer, but he made Rockefeller mad one day. He still don't know what happened. But David Kennerly put him on the staff of Gerald Ford. When it's just two black people and a sea of white folks shooting pictures at the graduation at Ohio State, I'm shooting because the yearbook assigned it to me. And Ricardo, look, who are you? Who are you? You know, to see somebody with as many cameras as I had, and he's like, God, where do you live? I said, Washington. I said, where do you live? Washington. So next time I go home, we get together. I meet Roland Freeman. Turns out Roland is married to the lady who taught me French when I was in high school. It's such a small world.
It is. So what point in your life do you think you decided, I want to do photography first of all? But what might have impacted your life to the point that you ended up being the director of photography for the President of the United States?
You never know where things are gonna lead you. I never cussed anybody out, no matter how frustrated I might be. I always found a way to get around what I call obstacles. If somebody was telling me what I couldn't do, I'd go, really, why? And if they couldn't answer it enough, I said, where's your boss? They gotta get the boss. Mm-hmm. Well, who's in charge? Uh-huh. Okay, let's talk to you then. And I'm very calm about what I have to do and who sent me. And I'm not pulling any paperwork out because I feel like as a human being, I can talk to you about this. Now, if you want me to prove something to you, you gotta say prove something. Then I'm gonna ask you to prove to me that you're a decent human being. I'm looking for a fair chance. And I'm not taking no smack, because if you take smack, the other photographers around you go, oh, she's weak. Oh, that woman is big. That's bad in this kind of business. So if you bumped me and gave me an elbow, oh, you got one bad. People would not see me do it. I'm just a good, I know how to, it's real short, listen. I know where to get you at, why? I took karate for 15 years, and I know what parts on your body that I can get you. And I don't use it unless I have to. But the fun thing about karate, it gives you courage about things. It gives you courage to know you're not being treated fairly. And it incites you to do more good work. Because the bottom line about photography is, you're only as good as your last image. Mm. And some of them images you fail in front of you. You want to live with that for 3 days. Oh, no, I messed up. Or how about you didn't load the camera right? You're supposed to wait till the return wheel is turning the same time you're advancing the film. And I didn't pay attention one day. I got to the Washington Post, and I'm in the dark room, super my film up and up, and it's all fixed and thing, and I hung up the drag on. Oh,
I ain't no camera right.
So I ran out to a phone by the dark room and called the client I just done the work for, going, hey, you still there?
I'm coming back.
And I run back and go reshoot where I messed up the last time. Never happened again. But for several days in a row, I'd wake up in the middle of the night and go, oh my God,
Well, thank heavens I saved myself.
Because you never want to fail at doing what you're trying to do.
Now, you showed us some wonderful photos, just a small number, I know, of the photos that you've taken over the years, especially the 8 years that you were with President Clinton, the thousands of miles that you all traveled together, all the different places you woke up finding yourself in. If you think back over those 8 years, what are one or two of the most impactful moments? Can you recall?
I would say in Mongolia with Mrs. Clinton, because I could not believe what Mongolia looked like and how the people were and the yaks and the yak jump. Culture shock. Anywhere we were in Africa, any country, I'm pinching myself going, oh my God, I'm at the motherland. I'm Southeast girl. It's out of town. It was terrific because you meet all these great, wonderful folks who have lives like yours. They're trying to make a way out of no way too, but I'm feeling a little bit fortunate that I'm getting to actually shoot this stuff, and it's going to be historical. Well, you're a young photographer. He said, oh, what's going to happen to my work? Am I going to be good enough to make the encyclopedia? Because that's what I grew up on. Looking at all the pictures in the encyclopedia telling you the history and things, and I hope I make the encyclopedia one day. I didn't care if you got credit or not. It's just that your picture is in the encyclopedia. But as time goes on, I start doing photo shows, and actually asking better photographers to critique my work, I learned how to get better. I study, I work my camera. If I got some time to myself, I'll go somewhere and look for pictures. When you're on the hunt for pictures, you ain't hurt nothing. But you're gonna be a better photographer because the light keeps changing, where you're going is changing, and I'm so self-absorbed about it. Let me see if I can get a good art piece out of that. Because I exhibit, and people love to tell you what they think of your work, and they'll tell you it's not good either. So I grew up under the old school of show it off, take the critiques, and get a thick skin. It was fun. I'm still having fun. Because no matter whose pictures I critique, who's an up-and-coming student, they'll show me their work. And I say, well, you got now critique mine. And they're going to be like, critique yours. And see, now in the old days, I had to have a proof sheet or something that let them see the images. Now I can just have an iPad or a computer and Google my name and go to images and all kind of stuff pop up. I say, so critique my stuff. What can I do to improve me? You're asking me how to improve you? Yeah, I want to know. You student, you see stuff, you're getting better. Well, so how can I get better? Oh, no, Sharon, I don't know how to get better. You do, try. So if you force young folk to talk to you about your work and you're talking to them about their work, it's only fair to put the shoe on the other foot. It just gets better.
That's great, and I'm going to jump off that a little bit. If you're like me, I never dreamed or imagined that I'd end up doing some of the things that I've done, especially working for President of the United States and working in positions that had never been held before. So if there's a young person out there, and you talked a little bit about that, what are some foolproof keys to making sure that your journey ends in success? What are some things now that you're looking back that you know that you did right and you would suggest to them?
Never lie. Because by the time they search out your past and your history, they don't make the people you went to elementary school with. They go to your junior high school mates, your college people. And you don't know until you're sitting in front of an FBI agent when you're going through security clearance. And he'll say, what about the stuff you did? So what? He says, you have an FBI record. That ain't news to me, I know that. You know, so what's the issue? He says, you must have lied about something. I said, y'all lie. That's what y'all did. I don't do that. And so he got back to my office before I did. And he's telling my boss, wow, she's got a record. And Bob said, look here, we all did something before we got here. Get out of my office. I'm like, yes! Somebody that cares about their people. I love it. So that's how I got started. The other thing is that you never stop studying photography. You never stop understanding how to make a better picture. I go to other people's talks about photography. I go, we got the Smithsonian. We can see everything for free. There's no excuse not to take my free time and go look, and be inspired. Because if you're inspired, the next time you're going, hey, you think about the things you saw? Can I get there? Can I be on that level? Get some more critiques. It's fabulous. A young person has to keep looking and doing. You cannot just read a book and think it's going to give you the magic of photography.
No, you got to go do it. You can't dream about, I should have been down there. You need to be down there. And whatever event is going on, do your research. You need to figure out what kind of light is where you're going to be. So whatever time the event is you're going to do, wherever it's going to be, you got to be there at the same time the day before so you can see how the light is. And if you understand where the light is, you're going to know where the sun is at your back to light everything up, or you're going to know where not to be because you're going to get flare and glare. If it's an inside space, you do test shots. You fire things off and measure what your light meter. So when you go in there to really go do the job, you have a good general idea how things are going to be. You get more perfection like that. And back in those days, all you get was 36 shots off a roll. You got two rolls in your pocket, you better get going. And you got to be very spacious about waiting. So I didn't shoot unless it moved. If you don't move, I don't shoot. There's also the action photography. The other thing about your reputation is that I got to the White House because Bob said he knew my work before he read the credits in the Washington Post. And it's no better. Made my heart go, really? So when his wife called to say to me, hey, you, my husband's going to be President Clinton's photographer. He wants you to work with him. Yeah, right. I hung up because I'm working trying to get 30 prints out before noon. And it's 8 o'clock in the morning. And I know it's going to take me a little while because I'm in the basement. I work out the furnace room in the house. You know, you make everything dark. I got a TV with a red screen over it so I can keep track of the news and stuff. But I'm trying to get these prints out. She calls back a second time. As soon as I hear her voice, I'm like, no, not today. I can't deal with it. And she calls a third time. Hey, you, listen. We had a party last night. Half the room knows you and your phone number. Now I'm listening. And she says, whose house is that? Oh, boy. And she says, my husband's going to call you in a couple of weeks. Well, he doesn't. He doesn't call even in a month. But 2 weeks before the inauguration, he's calling, telling me to meet this guy at this tree on this date. I'm like, yeah, right. And I don't tell anybody, because some of us have put together portfolios to work the inaugurations. I ain't say nothing to my mom and dad. Nobody didn't tell us so. Didn't even tell Joyce. I ain't tell nobody. So when I find that tree and that guy, I'm like, really? And next thing I know, I'm working. The wild part was I didn't have the right credentials around my neck, 3 different occasions in that same spot. First time I was up there, everything's fine. They're like, oh, look at your freelancers here. Look at Sharon. Sharon working inauguration. Yeah. No, y'all stop that. Okay. I'm here to work like y'all. And so I get in my spot. I'm ready. Yeah, let's let it rock and roll. Agents come by. Look at me. No, that's not the right stuff. Excuse me? That ain't for this. What do you mean? No, come down. Come on down.
What?
So I come down with my group. Go find the guy. At the tree again. I'm saying, Sam, he said, here, put this on, go back. So I put on the new stuff and give that, go back. And I'm up on the stand for about another 20 minutes. Here come another set of agents. No, they ain't got the right stuff.
What?
And by now, the press corps around me is high on going, you leave her alone, leave her alone. And I'm like, oh, man. And they said, you gotta get down, you don't have the right stuff. So I left my gear there. No, I didn't leave my gear, I never leave my gear. I left and went and found Sam again. Everything Sam has around his neck, he throws on me. When I go back, somebody else is in my spot. And the whole crowd of those guys and gals say to that photographer, you gotta move. Sharon's been here 3 times now. Better have a spot. So that's how I got started.
Oh, wow. That's great. That's a great story.
And it would have done it if I hadn't been a nice person. I don't cut nobody out at all. Never. Even if I get mad about something, I can't have backwards. Look at here. You mad. When he's busy telling me stuff I don't want to hear. 396, 95. You just said what? 500, 498. And it works. It keeps me calm. I don't make nobody mad. I've discovered the art of Zen.
That's pretty cool.
That is great. I love that story. I want to ask you this. I don't know about you in photography. When you're younger, a lot of us look at people that we want to emulate, we want to be like when we grow older. Did you have heroes or
people? Mom and Dad.
All right.
They educated me. They educated me. My father would wrap my comic books up with masking tape and say, I didn't get all A's. I'm looking at him like, I'm 9 years old. What's the problem? And he says, you get your books back and your grades get better.
What?
No. and you can't buy any books either.
Huh?
Now, come on, Pop. And my mother's like, no, we concur. Mom, you can't let Dad do that. And you're not listening. We concur. Oh, good God Almighty. So it made me play piano harder, because I started learning at 8, and now I've discovered beyond the stuff of Mozart and all those other, Chopin. And I'm starting to buy music, just Temptations, Martha the Band, we all dance in the street. I'm playing shotgun, and I'm happy with music. I still play my classical, so I can be good at that too. And they don't care what time of day I play piano. I'm just like thrilled to death. So they encouraged what I was doing, and they were good at what they did. By the time I got to the 8th grade, my mother was the first woman of color who was a principal in Prince George's County outside of Washington, D.C. And then the next year, my father becomes an assistant principal at Kent Junior High. And I'm like, oh, this is bad. This is bad. Your principal's now, it's going to get worse. What are they going to do to me next? Oh, this is bad. And my brother says, chill. They're not ministers. They're safe.
Did you know any African American photographers when you were growing up?
My uncle, my mom, and her sister would send my uncle money so he could take pictures and make money on campus. And then he told them, if you let me buy a camera, I don't have to borrow any more money from you. So they said, okay. They put their money together so he could buy a camera, because he was borrowing somebody else's camera to do stuff. And he bought a camera, and he put himself through school while he was in ROTC there. My uncle was a pistol. Years later, after I graduate, I'm at my grandmother's house, and this whole box of stuff he shot in the 40s is there. And I see pictures of me in the negatives, little kid looking like a little lamb on her way to Easter. I don't dress like that anymore. But I understood that it was historical. I'm looking at me and my cousins who are taller than me. I'm the shortest thing out there. My brother's not born yet. And I'm just like, wow, I never saw me like that. I don't want to see me like that again, but it's fun, you know? Because you realize it's a continuity about how you get old and what you learn. And I always love reading. I'm a readaholic. Read anything, anytime, anywhere. But that's what happened. My uncle Junior.
Wow. I want to ask you this. You've done so much. You've been in so many different places. You've met so many people. Are you still inside the same little girl that grew up in Washington, D.C.?
Yeah, because I still hang out with my buddies. I keep my friends. Friends are some of the greatest gifts you can ever have in life. And the older you get with your friends, the more nuances you're aware of, the more you love them. Friends are a special gift. To meet new people, it takes a little bit of time for me to figure out if you're as real as my friends. And I always said that art gave me courage, and also gave me comrades with courage. So whatever I tried to do, I was supported by my community. I never lost my mind. When we would go away on trips and I couldn't make it to the dinner or lunches we were invited to, I always called and apologized. I would love to be there, but I can't. And if I could come, I would go. I just wouldn't be as crazy as the rest of them, because I don't want nothing to get back to nobody. So I would just keep myself calm, be happy to see my friends hug. We were a performance bunch, just like 40 of us, in theater, dance, visual arts, poetry, book writing. We eclectic. And we're operating out of a small carriage house behind somebody's house in Washington, D.C. And we started being open 2 days a week, then 3, then 5, then 7 days a week. We are holding our craft, performing for each other. Joyce and I put up one of the first photo exhibits in the place, and things grew. And you get responses from people about what your work is. It's encouraging to do more. As your friend says, Sherry, you're pretty good.
Really?
Is it okay? Yeah, it's great. Oh, and by the way, we want to perform. You think you can take our picture?
Yeah.
So when you start taking pictures for other groups and organizations, it's like, do give me my photo credit so people know who shot this photo. Never let somebody use your work, photographers, without getting your credit, because those credits lead to other work. And next thing I know, I'm busy. When I did Sweet Honey the Rock's cover, I'm doing an inside, they made this inside book with it. And Bernice Johnson Reagan also worked at the Smithsonian Institution, which I started doing work for too. And she said, I like my pictures clear, I like my pictures sharp, and I wanted to be about something. I can fulfill all those things. So when you realize you can do that, she's happy, and she's a taskmaster too. It's like, and she's also my friend who asked me why I was not working for myself. And I'm having a great career, and I'm not even 30 years old yet. By the time I'm hitting 40, it's like, hey, I'm having a great time. I'm selling work. I stay busy with the Delta Sigma Thetas and American Association and other people of science. A guy asked me to do Sunday school for him. And I'm like, Sunday school? You want to come shoot the Sunday school? Okay. And he said, how much are you going to charge me? I said, Sunday school, I can't charge you anymore. My mother and father would never care if I charged you. So 3 years later, he is working for a company out in Virginia. He calls me up. Sharon, I need a photographer. Sure, Sunday school? He's like, because of Sunday school, I got this job for paying $3,000. Oh, cool. Sunday school, that's paid off.
I was going to make my final question to you. I was going to ask you to leave a nugget of wisdom for the young people, especially that's in the audience. And you can do that as well. But I also want to know, if you were not Sharon Farmer, the photographer, photojournalist, who would Sharon Farmer be?
Sharon Farmer, the musician. Because I love music. I love practicing. I like getting into a groove. But I would tell young people, never turn down a chance to do a job, no matter what it is, what it pays. If you haven't figured out yet how to be the best photographer you can be, you can practice on everybody and everything. Which means you also have to be proactive. If you don't have an assignment that day, if you got some time, go someplace and take some pictures and ask your friends to look at them. 4 years ago, we founded exposuregroup.org. And we're about the art and business of photography. I had joined ASMP, hoping that my Caucasian brothers and sisters would share with me the secrets of the business and the arts. And they didn't. So the more I read, the more I found out, me and six other photographers are like, we need to make our own group. Are we going to invite white folk? Yeah, we need to be fair, invite them too, so they see how much they're going to miss us. I said, okay. So we had some members for a little while, and we're about 50 members now. Two people are from out of town. We just meet the second Wednesday of every month. We start at 7 o'clock, we finish at 8:30. It's about the art and business. And plus, we're telling young people to hone yourself. So we invite you to come to the meetings. If you're a student, come on. First meeting is always on us, because you got to see how wonderful we are. And once you come to the meeting, you go, yeah, I come back to that. They actually got knowledge for me. Yeah, we got knowledge, because if we don't share stuff, I don't care what it is, we're not a good bunch of human beings. And we have to share everything. The inside tip, what the weather's going to be, how you get a good job, how you take care of your families, how you make the salt money away for the rainy day. Because for everybody, the rainy day's gonna come at some point. And if you don't have some cash reserved, you don't wanna be like jacked up. That's what the word I'm gonna use. You don't get jacked up because you don't have much. And you can't always call on your parents because you're trying to prove to them, I can handle it. I can handle this. And I just kept taking work no matter what it was. Every job I took taught me something. And when I'm reviewing my pictures with my little eye looking down deep and going, oh no, oh no. Then you go, the gym. The rise and falls of emotions as you go through your proof sheets and your negatives is better than football. Okay? It's better than football. You feel the debt that you got something that's going to be maybe lasting the sense of time. It's timeless. Doesn't matter when you shot it, it's like a good, strong, wonderful image. I sell my work as fine art. Not everything, some things that I go, this is a gem. And you put the gems away in a separate place because it's fun to be able to, Jim, we have an exhibit, what you got? And you can pull out stuff you got. In June, I'm going out to the Annenberg Center for Photography that's at the old, 20th Century Mall out there. And that's a big, huge exhibition space. And they found my work at the Library of Congress. Library of Congress bought a body of my work about 4 or 5 years ago. And they bought about 20 images. What? Really? What? Okay. And we're out of the White House by then, but I've always been an exhibition photographer because the nerve to show your work is important. It's as important as getting a good education. So you get feedback. Feedback is not going to kill anybody about anything. It's the most benign thing to be criticized and critiqued about whatever it is you're doing. Even my piano playing, and I'm trying to be a funketeer bass player. And somebody like, Sharon, go back to piano. And so now I'm taking bass lessons, you know, because I'm going to be a funketeer. I came up under George Clinton and the Funkadelics. And I also like the blues. And for a lot of years, from, 89 until I joined the White House crew, we had music at my house every Tuesday night. Photographers, journalists, people doing the news on the radio. We had a plenty bunch of folks. And there's 12 to 15 people in our house every week. We eat, drink, and be merry. Now, if your kid comes, everything goes away but the food. You bring your 12-year-old in there, put that stuff away, he's coming. Don't want to put it in there. Get your ass up. Is this a water shed? Oh, water, okay. Well, we jam from 7 o'clock until 11 or later, depending on what's got to happen the next day on a Wednesday. But for most of us, Tuesday was a night we were not obligated to be with family or do a job. And we all grew as a group. We were singing. So my dining room at home is a music room. I got all kinds of music stuff up there. And when I traveled with the Clintons, I bought musical instruments from around the world. So I got an eclectic set of stuff. We get together, you can play anything in my house you see. Because everything makes a different kind of tone. And then the other thing about music, as you jam with your friends, you get into a meditative thing about what you're trying to accomplish as you listen to each other. You have to listen to be able to play together. Oh, it's a great learning tool about how to be cool, you know?
Thank you. Please give a round. I think we have microphones on each of the sides of
us. Hit the microphone, brother, so I can hear your question.
All right. Can you hear me? I want to thank you so much for being here. You're very much an inspiration to me, and I think everybody here appreciates you as well, very much so. I'm a young man. I'm very inspired by your story. I've been through a lot of things myself personally. I'm honored to say that I'm the governor's photographer of this state.
You don't want to send me a message today.
Yes, ma'am. And I was hoping that I could contact with you because to hear your story has been very inspirational to me, to say the least. One of the things I want to, and I'll try to be brief, to try to get an understanding of your courageousness. Did it come from, you know, your upbringing before your job, or did you find this while you was working? And some of the other things I want to get your opinion on is, like, have you ever been in a position where you have to zone out of this mindset of being a photo journalist to, you know, like, if you've ever encountered things where you've been some security measures, you know, working with COVID and things.
Hey, like, I'm the first one that go on. You can't go that way.
Yes.
And I'm like, don't you see that pen? I passed through. Don't you see that pen? And it doesn't matter who it is. It's like, all you can do is just go chop a thing and do this kind of work. And I've been stopped by police cars trying to walk across the tarmac to get to where I'm supposed to be at. And the car went from Burbank in California. Man, they watched too many chip movies. telling me, get over there with the rest of them. Excuse me. Hello? Get over there with who? Those nice people over there? I love those people. But I got to do my work. You see this pen?
I don't care about that pen.
You don't want to call on the Secret Service to call somebody out because their job is to guard the president, not worry about me. But one of the agents saw was getting a very hard way to go. And when I wouldn't listen to the cop, he's going to edge his car up close. And when he got too close, I banged the car. Oh, he's hopping out of the car, going to talk smack. And I'm just real calm going, 300, 200. And one of the agents comes over and tells the guy, I can go anywhere I want. And if he doesn't recognize that pin, then he missed a briefing. He said, come no matter what. My worst time was in Montana. I think it was Butte, Montana. And I went upstairs to the balcony because I could get a better overall shot showing the craft and the people and the actions of the president. And the sheriff comes up there telling me I can't be up there. And I said, oh, yeah, I can.
And he puts his hand on his gun, boy.
What did I just tell you? And I'm just like, ah, 500. And I yelled downstairs to Sam, the advance man. I said, Sam, I need your help. What's the matter, sheriff? I said, God got his hand on the gun butt.
Sam's eyes get big.
And he runs up the steps. And he tells the guy, she's with us. She's with us. She's with us. And by that, I quit counting. I'm calm. The guy has to leave. I get back to doing my job. Never let him see a sweat. Whatever. But if you stay calm and cool, you're going to get your word.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yes, my name is Dave Anderson. I work for Delta Ground.
I had the fortune to work with at the White House. Yeah. He was good and thorough and had a sense of humor like anybody else.
Takes one to know one. first of all, just want to thank both of you for awesomeness because that's what your lives are.
Oh, thank you.
Janice, when is the Kearney family going to be put on a stage to be interviewed on how to be better than everyone else? You guys are unbelievable. And Sharon, I just want to thank you for
being a wild child. Yes, I am a wild child.
I didn't think I could cheer you about this, but you like just bring love to everybody.
Because you're a man who you love, but you're a bad dude, man.
You know, I was a 22-year-old at the White House wondering how in the world I got so lucky, and you're just there giving a hug every day.
You know,
if you went through every Sharon contact sheet, she'd have more smiles per contact sheet than any photographer in the history of the world. You mark my words. So I love this shit.
I have two questions, and actually one of them has to do with your tight group. A few weeks ago, I was at a dinner with the Clintons' diarist. She was the first ever, I believe. And I'm wondering how much time the two of you got to spend together, I'm assuming, because she was right on his footsteps all the time, and you probably were too. And the second question was there ever a time when you were not allowed into a room or a situation, even though you did have top secret clearance?
I was allowed to be me. And I knew my job was to be the historian that documented. And people would try to throw me out the room, and I'd walk up to them and whisper in their ear, I don't work for you. And I'd go back to what I was doing. And the persons we dumbfounded. They didn't know what to say. They weren't counting backwards that I could tell. You could see on their face. So that was pretty neat. It all works out. I'm fortunate that as I roam the White House, even if I'm not shooting President Clinton per se or Mrs. Clinton, my comrades who work at the White House with me are working and doing things. Janice had a little nook in the corner in one of the offices. And I always stuck my head in there to say hi to everybody. Because the people who don't travel with us like we do, they're precious. They keep the home fires going at the White House. And when 5 o'clock rolled around, we didn't run out. Because we knew California was still open, Hawaii's still working, Alaska's still working. We don't go home at 5 o'clock like this group does now. So we care about stuff. Eugene Sperling, the economics advisor. He is so concerned about getting the figures right for budgets and things. When I'm leaving out of there because President Clinton stayed up late giving a tour of the White House with his guests, the same time I'm leaving at 1 o'clock in the morning, so is Gene Sperling. I see Gene when I come in, And here me and Gina going out together. I'm just like, what kind of days we had? A lot of times it could be 12-hour days. Remember, there's only four of us. Whoever comes in at 7 o'clock in the morning does the job with President Clinton. Whoever comes in at 8 o'clock in the morning is working with Mrs. Clinton. Wherever she goes, you too. If you come in at noon, you don't know when you go home. Because if the guy stays up in his office working on stuff, making phone calls, doing meetings with the national security people, we gotta be there because we are documenting stuff. When somebody made the mistake of trying to land a plane on the South Lawn at the White House, not knowing that in the dark you cannot see all the roads that have been put up for the photographers and the media for the next day's event, well, he crashed and he died. And he also broke up the old magnolia tree that had been there since Jefferson. So you realize, what a place, what a place. Mm-hmm. And then as time went on, we began to have more fist jumpers. But these guys in black suits rolled out the ground. And they gonna get you. Because they got sensitivity, sensors all over the place. You can't be making a mess and not have some trouble. But it was a good time at the right time. And nothing ever stays the same. We have illusions that not much has changed. But yeah, man, prices have gone up, everything costs more. Traffic in D.C. is unbelievable now. It took me 15 minutes to get down to the White House from my house in Columbia Heights. Now when I go to town, it can take an hour in the morning because the traffic is bumper to bumper coming from Maryland. I live on off of Sherman Avenue over there. That's a main drag to get down there. The subway's okay, but usually I got a lot of gear, and I'm not riding the subway with some gear. I might hurt you, you know? And at the White House, I could leave my gear and just travel without it till it was time to be someplace. But as I get older, I'm doing work for tanks and people doing events and rallies. I love events and rallies. I'm back in my civil issues thing. So one of my new clients is Common Concerns, who was concerned like me about a lot of things that are not happening for the American folks that they need to happen. So I work for people who do cool things. Now, I do work for corporations too. So I got the best in, I got the best of both worlds. So I'm still having fun as a photographer, still getting to create. And I'm now working on, if I see something that looks interesting, I'm not waiting, hoping it's gonna be here when I get back, shoot it right now. And sometimes it's just a reflection off of a light panel, and somehow I can see the people on stage from a different angle. It's an art piece. And I just make sure that I up my ASA higher so I can see the detail of the shadows. I slow my shutter speed down so I know I'm gonna catch it. And if I make it f-stop just right, everything I shot on that panel, all three of the people gonna be in focus. I'm doing art, so I'm happy. You want to have lunch? No, I want to do my art. All you need. The images feed me. The excitement of whatever the event is. At Brookings, the things they discuss, be it the infrastructure of the rails and bridges around everywhere, or that how are we going to deal with the new coin of the realm that it wants to be, the Bitcoin. Don't y'all buy no Bitcoin. Yeah. And like the Prime Minister of Greenland came down a year ago, and some people laughed at some remark he made about all the water that's coming from us is coming straight to you. And a couple of people giggled. And the guy said, you don't get it. Whatever's up top of us is coming to you. You're gonna lose your land mass too. I'm like, holy moly. So I am very interested in what's going on with nature and how things grow. We've had a garden in our backyard for the last 15 years because they keep putting things in food that aren't good for us. If I see three syllables on a package, it goes back. If you have more than 50 milligrams of salt and whatever this is, it goes back. I'm looking for 20 or less. How do I get 20 or less? I cook at home. I'm a big cook. I turn into a chef. The guy, the girl used to bake pizza pan and hot dogs all the time. Now I love salad. I love salad. And then we make pastas, you know? Keep the salt down. I'm supposed to put salt in the water to make it take. No, salt goes in, no water. So the cuisine at the house is good. People come over, look, they make a red cabbage salad with red oranges and orange oranges and some lime juice and thinly sliced red cabbage. I never liked cabbage before, cooked or uncooked.
like it now.
One other quick question. Canon or Nikon?
I'm a Canon woman. You know why? Let me tell you why. When I did the first inauguration for President Clinton, I got all my Nikon gear. And then the boss, Bob, says, Michael, sure, it's a Canon rep. And he's got a 600 millimeter lens for you to use for the inauguration. 600 millimeters? Yeah. It's a 2.8 lens? Whoa. Because I'm strong, I could carry the lens. And then one of the Navy guys carried that heavy tripod for me. It pays off to stay in shape. I didn't know why I was staying in shape. I just knew I didn't want to see the doctors. Because I think most doctors are practicing, and some of my friends like the way they talk about. And I said, you're going to practice all me laughing like that. And these guys still smoke and drink. Oh, no, no, no. You can't follow your own rules. I'm not listening to you. And then I said, the best way to stay away from quacks is stay in shape. So I watch what I eat. I watch what I drink. I'm overindulged in anything but vegetables.
Thank you so much for being here and for radiating the encouragement and enthusiasm you displayed for me. I'm a photographer and musician myself, so you're my kind of people. My question is, when you were working with the Clintons, the nature of your relationship with them while you're working, were you like, did you both pretend that you're invisible? And you just kind of moved around and shot what was happening, or did you ever like direct them a little bit?
No direction, because you take away reality. And I'm a photojournalist by trade. I'm a documentary photographer. I'm not doing fashion. I'm not trying to show things that aren't real. So I don't tell anybody what to do. The natural order of things is better, because when you do that, it's a real picture to me. If you got an orchestrated picture, it has to be in the studio because you want everybody to set up right, you want the light right, you want the clothing right, you want the background right. It's different. But doing work for them, as it is what I shoot. I'm not telling you anything unless something is like blatantly, you got some ketchup on you, you didn't know. But other than that, no, because I don't want to manipulate anything. I like things as they are. My parents were like that. As you come, that's as you are. My biggest thing my mother would say was dress neat. I did that, but when she tried to get me to fry my hair, lay it to the side, or dye it, I'm like, ow! No, no, no! Ain't frying that, or lay it to the side. And she said, what you gonna do? Wear my afro puff. My mother's like, come on, come on, Sharon. Now look at here, I've never said you had to do something. Right, except I quit my job, which you did anyway. Yeah, I did do that, did I? But if you don't let things unfold, what are you scared of? I'm not scared of anything. My parents raised me to have courage. They worked with people who didn't have it as good as we had it. We had to give back to our community so everybody can thrive. If one is having a fit, then we're all going to have a fit. So I'm so glad I was born to the people I was born to, because some of my friends are getting whipped down the street. And I'm just like, I'm glad that never happened to me. We didn't get spanked when I was growing up. By the time I got to talking to you, you wish you hadn't done. And then my father, no matter what you did 2 or 3 weeks ago, if you're in the kitchen washing dishes, you're trapped. One or the other will sit down and go, remember that thing you did a few weeks ago? That's one. No, you're losing track of what you did that they got you for. And they'll go back through it painfully, just like you did it today. Oh, it just break my heart. I had to hear them again. But you always look your parents dead in the eye. And while I'm washing the dishes, I'm half turned. So my father knows I'm paying attention. And I'm going, oh, this dishwasher is hot. And I really want to put these dishes down. If I stop, he's going to say, well, sit down and talk to me some more. I'm still washing dishes when I really want to go, don't torture me, don't torture me. And then if I go outside, I'm about to come back inside again, my mother's standing on the porch. Hey, you know that thing you did yesterday? Huh? Which one? And she goes through it just like it was today. I learned very quick, if I didn't want to hear from them about what I did was wrong,
If I didn't get beat, like, I want to say so bad, school didn't beat me and beat none of them.
But they weren't into punishing kids. They didn't do that in schools either. So I learned to be a better kid.
This is the last question. One more question.
He's coming up to
two more questions.
There's three more questions.
Oh my goodness.
Good evening, Sharon. I'm Phyllis Hodges. I'm just amazed I'm listening to you. You are blessing my heart. Your personality is off the chain, girl.
My parents. How many I keep with my parents?
Oh my God, it's awesome. You're sitting next to one of my mentors. And Janice, no, I take pictures everywhere I go with this, you know, plain old little lousy phone. And I got a couple of questions to ask you. First of all, when everything is over, can we take a selfie together?
Absolutely.
Okay, that's one thing. The second thing is, looking at your beautiful work that you showed a few minutes ago, the senior that had the hula hoop around her waist, tell us a little bit about her.
She's been living in Brentwood all her life. She lived with her family, and while they were away at work, she would prepare the food for dinner when they came home. And she's with her older friends. Some of her older friends have already passed away. So to get to the store, she rode her bike. She didn't per se want to walk. But to stay in shape, as she said, she liked hula hooping. She remembered it from being a kid. So that was just fascinating, because even I did hula hoops when I was a kid. And here I am younger than her, and I'm not doing a hula hoop again like that. I don't even have a hula hoop. But she had four of them in different colors. So I knew this was a serious hula hoop master here. And then when the thing stayed up, I'm like, whoa, oh, whoa. And she had some moves, girl. Oh boy, it's just a thrill to see. What's an example to me? No matter how old you get, keep moving, keep doing stuff. My parents used to entertain their friends at the house. And my mother had made a basement that looked like a tropical world. They had rattan furniture all over the place. And it took me a while to fall in love with that. Like, why is mom aiming like this? I don't get it. But our basement didn't look like anybody else's anywhere. So as time goes on, I begin to appreciate what things look like. The other fun stuff is because my mother steps outside the box, her other friends had joined sorority, but my mom said, I gotta deal with school. When I retire, I'm gonna join the sorority you and Del are in. So she became a Del, so I got the pen. It was one of the proudest moments of my life. My dad was already a captain, and he used to go out dressed to the nines, and I'd pull out my heavy-duty photo gear and set it up, and tell him, before you all come out the house, I gotta get this shot. And I'd always put a light with a colored gel behind them, so it looked more artsy. And then they say, we're going out. We may not get home till tomorrow afternoon. Okay. Really? I don't stay out there late nowhere. But my parents loved to go out and dress up, and so did their friends. And they'd order party platters. And I looked at the party platters, got the saran going, really? You don't want to eat all? Yeah. And anybody bring something, they bring their BYOB stuff with the wine and the liquor and things. And when they leave out the house at 10 o'clock, I can see them till the next day. I didn't think much about it except to say, no matter how old they got, they enjoyed each other. When they got to their 50th anniversary, President Clinton called at the venue. We were celebrating them for having been married 50 years. I'm blown away. He's calling. How do you know about this? I didn't say nothing to nobody. But somehow he did. And they are thrilled to death to hear the president's voice tell them happy anniversary. And I'm just like, oh my Lord. So when I saw him the following few days, I'm like, sir, thank you so much. He says, you deserve it because they made you. And you are just for yourself.
That's awesome. And I think the reason that particular picture got my attention, she was a senior, again, exercising. In a few days, I'll be 60. I own a health and wellness center. So, and my oldest client is 102. So just listening to that and just watching you is blessing me. So we're going to take a picture when everything is over, okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good day, everybody. I'm not good at public speaking. But my question was, maybe two or three. But as a photographer, when did you learn your worth as a photographer?
Say it again?
When did you learn your worth as a photographer?
Oh, man. I bought a book years ago when I was in college called How to Swim with Sharks. And it was a book about negotiating whatever you thought you were worth. I also got two books by John Harrington called The Business of Photography. But it was negatives, it was one thing. This digital thing made him have to do another book. And the things that have happened since then, the third book is coming out in another month. I'm just thrilled to death that I can ask my peers, what would they do in certain situations? And then I have books I can refer to. I also go online, looking up whatever topic it is I'm looking for. I may get 20 different ways of looking at things, and I sit up all night long reading all this stuff so I know something about what I'm doing. It never hurts to read, and it never, ever hurts to ask somebody for advice, because I can't reinvent the wheel, and I don't want to repeat other folks' ideas of what mistakes are. But I just want to be a dynamite photographer that makes a good living. I'm not trying to make all the money in the world. My happiness comes in being a creative person, and that I have the best of both worlds, working as a photographer and playing music on the side. I mean, it's cool.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Last one.
Listen, ma'am, peace be upon you. Some ladies sound on tip. I have a, what is your family photo of your family, the most precious, the oldest that you have, and was it taken by family members or yourself? The other question is, tell us about the most comical or the most ridiculous picture you got that became famous. And then tell us about one of the photos that came out of a spiritual experience, something like that.
Bernice Johnson Reagan is the most spiritual, down-to-earth person I ever met in my life. Her father was a minister in Albany, Georgia. And Bernice is short. And sometimes she would like bark at you. And I say, you trying to scare me? She said, yeah, I'm short. So I want you to be scared to do a good job. Oh, okay. Bernice is about 10 years older than me now. And she retired from Sweet Honey to Rock about 10 years ago. She's still doing work and doing music. Her and her daughter, Toshi Reagan, Toshi's put out some CDs that are wonderful. And she and Bernice have worked together on The Temptation of St. Anthony. They turned it into an opera that traveled across Europe about, I'll say, 5 or 6 years ago. And then recently, they put Octavia Butler's work, the science fiction writer, to music and song. And that's now traveling as an operetta. That's the spiritual, make you understand what you're about. Bernice served in the civil rights movement and was one of the freedom singers that could just wear it out. And her husband, Cordell, was in the group too. So these are great people who have put their lives at risk. By singing for your freedom, you're not afraid of Bull Connor and all the police officers or warders and batons to hit you upside the head. What they did to John Lewis was terrible. I saw the pictures. And he's still here, thank heavens. But a ridiculous picture? No, I keep thinking about the things that don't go right. And I never want to embarrass somebody being themselves. I don't try to shoot stuff that's not kind and nice and got a message. I'm just not into that. It's like you want to shoot a cartoon. No, I don't. There's so many things going on among all of us that's so serious. Everybody doesn't eat every day. Everybody doesn't get to go to a job every day that they love. They don't live with people who love them. So many people get battered. Kids don't get dealt with to make sure they get their vaccinations. This world is serious. The only place I find levity is with my friends, as we share what we've done that day or that week or where we've been. I couldn't shoot a ridiculous picture if I wanted to, because I don't want to embarrass nobody. I would not want to be embarrassed like that. And pictures can appear someplace where you wish they would not. Oh no, so if I don't shoot it, you can't use it.
Family member pictures.
And say again?
family member picture. I was asked, which family member picture that you may have of your family, the oldest picture, or one of the family pictures that you reverence, whether you took it or not?
I didn't take it. Either my cousins took it on my father's side of the family, or my uncle on my mother's side of the family. And I'm a little kid, and I'm just fascinated by my cousins, who watched out for me when my parents weren't around. Sometimes my parents would go away for a weekend, 2 days. I'm either at grandma's house or at my aunt's house, my mother's sister. I love pancakes early in the morning. They make waffles. They make sure we didn't have to eat no oatmeal. I like that. All those pictures of us growing up. Plus, my mother sewed. And we were going to a picnic, and my mother knew a month ahead of time where we were going to be on someday. She's gone out and bought a cloth. And she's got 4 different patterns, but all those patterns get turned into the same kind of material. So you can find the 4 farmers running around everywhere. And we all got the same material on them. All the shirts are different, how they're formed and made. And my mother sewed them all. She tricked me one year. She said, "Sharon, you know the model airplanes you put together, and Batman, Superman, yeah, I like that. And the crazy things you do." I said, "Oh, the drag racing cars, the guys got big eyes bugging out with fire coming out behind." She says, "Yes, that stuff." Okay, well, I have a better way for you to be more creative. How about how about making something from scratch? And I'm like, "Well, what's in it?" And she says, "We know, let me bring upstairs to the sewing room." And she says, "Now look at here, see this pattern? Uh-huh. You cut around that with the picking shears, cut each piece out very carefully. Try not to cut the black lines. Just go around that pattern. And then we're going to put it together." She suckered me into learning how to sew. I really didn't want to learn. I'd rather be doing something else. But it's like, I love my mom. And she and daddy never let me wrong about nothing. So here I am sewing. And I'm scared I'm going to be a pushover. And I'm telling my father, "I'm sewing. I'm sewing." And my dad says, "Your mother's a wonderful seamstress. And she has skills. I mean, look at her shirts. Look at this jacket she made." I'm like, "Yeah, you tough dad. Your mama made that." "Oh, okay. It's okay, Dad?" "Yeah, as long as I tell you it's time to work on the car and you still come out, it's okay."
Thank you, Sharon. Thank you so much.
Technical school here, because everything keeps growing, and folks who want to help you learn are the best folks in the world. And sometimes you don't know you're learning,
which means they're really a good teacher.
That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.